Well, as always, when Molly introduces me, I feel very humbled. I'm like, who is that fantastic person she's describing? I'm like, I don't know that person. But it is true that my most prized possession and achievement in this world is having these young people in my life, and of course my husband. My oldest daughter, Anna, is not able to be with us. She's in Dallas in a PhD program because she's going to be a professor teaching all of these great ideas coming forward. So why are we here? It's the Bringing America Back to Life convention, and what are we trying to do? As the PAVE motto, you guys have seen it all, pray, act, vote, and educate. And what Molly and I have tried to do when we do our book reviews on the radio program on From the Median is try to understand the ideas that are out there affecting society that's coming to us through literature, through movies, through short stories, just anecdotally that you pick up just talking to people through our education system. And how do we make ourselves sensitive to these terrible things that are happening in our society in a way that we're prepared to identify the bad ideas and to be able to confront those bad ideas? And as we were talking last night with Luke from the Lyceum, the whole idea is ideas have consequences. Good ideas will have good consequences, and bad ideas will bear the fruit of, give you bad consequences. And I'm not educated formally in literature, in history, in politics. I'm a CPA. My husband and I met in public accounting. We had 4 kids in 5 years, and we're going through the education process with our kids, and they'd bring home a textbook, and I go, well, that's not true. You know, I'd say, oh, well, here's how you answer the test, but here's the truth. And they'd be like, oh, God, there she goes again. You know, I was like always, telling them, it's like, well, wait a second. I know you have to answer the test that way. And it was funny because our youngest, Julia, would be like, oh, God, there they go talking about politics again. Does it always have to be politics and history? Yet when she got to high school and she was in her AP classes, she just flew through those history exams because she'd been paying attention all those years. But I've been very, very fortunate to have all these millennials, my daughter Olivia's husband, TJ, my son Michael's fiance, Elena, Julia's boyfriend, Alejandro, and of course, Anna in Texas, because I have learned so much from them that I've learned how to speak millennial. Sometimes I find it as my public service to actually decode millennial speak for people my age. They're like, what did they just say? You know? So when Molly asked me to be the chair of Cleveland Right to Life Symposium before it was a convention in 2012, I started thinking about formulating the ideas to try to pull together these ideas. And I think some of you may have been here when Dr. Ben Weicker was here. 2 years prior to that, my husband and I were at a conference in Orlando. And we're standing in line waiting to meet Justice Thomas from the Supreme Court. And they had a whole line of books that were standing there, so we're waiting to meet each other. And I go, oh my God, look at these books. And I go, I could have written this. And I'm going through and I'm like, this book is called 10 Books That Screwed Up the World and 5 That Didn't Help. And when you go through it, you start seeing how the Communist Manifesto and utilitarianism and the descent of man and beyond good and evil, all these things that by hearing the names of, we probably don't even realize what these people were doing. But back to 500 years ago, they started sowing in the late Enlightenment these horrible ideas to try to turn man on himself. And it's really a story that's as old as the Garden of Eden. What Molly and I do on the radio show is the very first one we said, okay, it's called From the Median. What does that mean? It means we're standing here in the middle of the road. You know you're on the highway in the median, and if you stand there, you got traffic going in 2 directions. Well, unfortunately, most of the traffic is like rush hour, going in 1 direction. And we're the cars going the opposite side on the highway, going against traffic. How are we going to increase the traffic going out of town as opposed to the traffic that's going in town? Those are the bad ideas and the good ideas. That's what she's talking about when she says from the median, the good ideas and the bad ideas. So Brian and I were talking, and I'm like, well, how do I start this whole idea of the book reviews? I said, we have to go back to the beginning. And then it dawned on me, you just go to Genesis, and you go right to the Garden of Eden, and the very first thing that the serpent does is he sneaks into the Garden of Eden, and he tells Eve, oh, don't mind God, he's just a man. And he's telling you that if you eat that apple, you'll be as great as him. You will be like a god. And what happened? Sowed the seeds of contention between man and woman, brings labor into the world, brings pain into the world, suffering into the world, sin into the world. And we have been living that battle ever since. But it's no different then as it was in the Tower of Babel, or the time of Christ, or the time that the church began, ancient Rome, the Renaissance. All of the ideas just keep recircling. But something has happened about 100 years ago where we divorced ourselves from the whole idea that history is a cumulative thing. And we've convinced ourselves in some kind of postmodern arrogance that we are at a different time in humanity, that man is now something new, that we are the masters of our own destiny, that we don't have to answer to a church, a God, you know, any set of morally objective standards. And that we've convinced ourselves that if we, in our own conscience, can reconcile something, then that's good enough. And unfortunately, that horrible thinking has permeated its way all the way into every institution that we cherish, into people in our universities, in our high schools. You know, even well-intended people in the church will bring forth utilitarian concepts, not knowing that that's what they're doing. You know, the whole idea with utilitarianism is that the worst thing that could happen to people is to suffer. Well, that's not the worst thing that could happen to people. The worst thing that could happen to people is damnation, right? As I learned from Pastor Moss, can I get an amen? But we've lost that idea that the worst thing that could happen is damnation, because we think the worst thing that can happen is suffering. So why do we need euthanasia? Oh, because that poor person who has cancer is going to suffer, and we don't want that. So it's just so much kinder to put them out of their misery, like they're an animal. You know, we've come to this terms that, well, with abortion, well, it's really a shame, but could you imagine bringing an unwanted child into the world? And what if they were poor? And, you know, it's just so much better to just end the problem before it becomes a bigger problem. You know, Nancy Pelosi, the great Catholic woman that she is, recipient of the Margaret Sanger Awards, just like Hillary Clinton, talks about that, well, of course abortion is necessary. How are we possibly going to afford all those poor children if we don't have abortion? You know, which are natural products of the sexual revolution. And so what Molly and I tried to do is take all of these big ideas and try to synthesize them through literature and try to think, well, if these are the ideas that destroyed society, what are the ideas that are going to redeem society? And all of those ideas that will redeem society come through the Redeemer himself. And those are the ideas that came to us through Judeo-Christian philosophy, theology, history. And Dr. Weicker has his counter book here. 10 books that every conservative must read, 4 not to miss, and 1 imposter. And it's a great title, except for the word conservative I have a problem with, because it kind of puts it into a political context for people. And you know, as soon as you say the word liberal or conservative, everybody's walls go up and go, I don't want to have a political conversation. So they kind of like shut down and stop listening to what you're saying. But in reality, what he's saying is if these are the ideas that permeated destruction of our society, of our families, of our churches, of our schools, these are the ideas that are going to get us back on the right course. Why? Because it brings back the search for goodness, truth, and beauty. Where here, it's not about goodness, truth, and beauty. It's about self-expedience and whatever makes me temporarily happy. It's about what does a healthy relationship look like? What would a healthy husband and wife look like? I mean, he's got all these great ideas. He goes back to the Federalist and the Anti-Federalist papers. He goes to Jane Austen. He goes, you know, all through these great pieces of literature. He brings in C.S. Lewis and Chesterton and all these great thinkers that are the people who really understood through their own brokenness what it takes to be truly human. Like, C.S. Lewis, one of the books that we did is called Abolition of Man. And this is another one of those ones that my dad brought to me years ago. And it's a book that C.S. Lewis wrote purely in response to a textbook he was given. Friends of his were professors in England in the 1930s and 40s, and they were experimenting with this brand new approach to teaching young people. And it was literally designed to overturn society. And he saw right through it, and he's just like, you know, if you put forth these policies, you're going to generate men without chests. And what did he mean? Men that had no virtue, no moral courage, no fortitude, no ability to stand up for their family, for their nation. And this is right after World War II. Well, how did the West beat tyranny? They had the moral fortitude of understanding what Judeo-Christian principles were all about. And they can say, no, we're not going to stand silently and watch you exterminate a whole class of people. And that they were willing to sacrifice their lives, their personal comfort, and their, you know, their material belongings, because they understood that a set of principles was bigger than themselves. Well, under the progressive ideology, the number one thing is the big government. It's about the authority, and their goal is one world governance. There's no accident that the United Nations and what they were talking about at lunch today, telling parents that they don't have the right to educate their children and that everybody has to have the same understanding of sexual freedom and reproductive rights. That's the whole goal of progressivism, and that's exactly what was being built upon 500 years ago, all the way back to Machiavelli, when they decided that they could overturn society. One of the things that is a repeat concept that just comes out time and time again is the distinction behind communism, socialism, environmentalism, sexual revolution, all these ideas that are the bad ideas. I call them the isms, right? You know, totalitarian concepts that come to us in one form or another. And they all want to do one set of things, and it's threefold. They always try to silence the church. They always try to break down the nuclear family. And they always try to separate people from their personal property. Why? Because those three concepts, those three things, were the core of Western civilization. Western civilization was built by the church. Universities came to us from the church. Hospitals came to us from the church. All the charities came to us from the church. It was through Judeo-Christian principles and philosophy that we learned that there's innate human dignity. Why? Because we are made in the image and likeness of God. Well, if I have turned this all on its head and now I am my own God, you know, like Nietzsche and will to power, you know, Übermensch, the Superman, that I can design what my understanding of freedom looks like, I can design what my understanding of sexual licentiousness looks like, that nobody can tell me what I can and cannot do. Well, that's not the Christian understanding of freedom. That's not liberty the way that it was understood by the founding fathers. That's not what a family needs to be able to thrive in society. But they knew that. I think there were a lot of people along the way who were well-intended, useful people along the process of turning society on its head. But the ones who put these policies into place, they knew exactly what they were trying to do. Because if you can destroy the nuclear family through divorce, contraception, abortion, euthanasia, all of the things that we see today rampant, then you have a whole society of people who are no longer connected to a greater good, to a greater whole. You know, when the most important thing is chasing money and a job that makes the most possible cash today, you're separated from your parents and your siblings and your aunts and your uncles and your cousins. And there's not really that connectedness to, you know, the greater extended family. Well, that was by design. When you look at communism, the very first thing they did after the Bolshevik Revolution was they nationalized the farms. Why? Because it was always understood in Judeo-Christian philosophy that what a person produces, and then it was an agrarian society, so you're talking about, you know, hay or corn or cattle. What that person produces manifests in their harvest. Well, that's because we're co-creators in God's natural order of things, so that the work of our hands, like they say at Mass, you know, the work of our hands, the fruit of the vine, that is a natural extension of our understanding of God creating the world through us in a continuous fashion. So what do they have to do? They have to undermine personal property rights. They do it by nationalizing industries. They do it by high tax rates. Anything they can do to separate a person from the works of their hands. And they do it by silencing the church. Has anybody heard of the Little Sisters of the Poor and the contraception mandate? Has there ever been a greater example of what Pope Paul VI predicted in Humanae Vitae, that the government would use contraception to be a coercive tool for population control? That's exactly what they did, and they did it on the backs of these sisters that poured out their whole lives for the good of society. So time and time again, when you go through these books, you see these ideas that are omnipresent. And Pastor, don't quote me on this. The reading from the Old Testament that says nothing is new, all things, Ecclesiastes? Yeah. Nothing is new in society. Everything just keeps coming back time and time again, but we've convinced ourselves that everything is new for us. I want to go through some of these books, and I'm just going to take them as I have them in the basket. This novel, which was also a box office smash, really shook me to my core, because I was sitting in the movie with my kids, and it was a trailer, and I go, oh my gosh, what a cute romantic comedy, I really want to see that. It's about a young man in a wheelchair and how the love of this young, beautiful girl is going to save him, and you know that he's going to see that his life has intrinsic value. And no, the whole idea of this is to convince her that her greatest good would be to come with him to a euthanasia center to help him die. And don't worry, I'll take care of you because I have money and you don't. So after you help me die, I will make sure that you're good for the rest of your life. It just turns everything that we hold dear on its head. And the objective of things like this is to soften our resistance to euthanasia. Oh, well, he's in a wheelchair and he used to have a great life and he had so much money and he could travel the world, and I wouldn't want to be in a wheelchair either, and you know what, maybe it is better to let him die. Well, who has the right to decide when somebody lives and somebody dies? So once they can break down that level of compassion, it doesn't take very long until we're now in the Netherlands. I think there was a two-year-old that the parents decided to euthanize a couple months ago because the child was diagnosed with cancer. And instead of letting that child suffer in any capacity, even though there was a chance that they would be able to heal the child, they didn't want that child to suffer, so they put the kid to sleep. This is where we are. And this is the natural fruit of the bad ideas that have been sown. I remember in 1973, I was 9 years old, and my mother sitting at the kitchen table, just crying with her head in her hands. And I was like, well, why? My mother was stoic. She was a first-generation Italian. Nothing rocked this woman. And she's sitting there just like, she's like, I never thought that I would live to see the day that they would allow people to kill a child in a mother's womb. She was reading the newspaper, and it was right after Roe v. Wade, and she was just beside herself. And she went on a one-woman personal crusade to let people know exactly what that meant. I remember in high school, I was horrified because, you know, when you're 15, 16, you never know what your parents are going to do that's going to embarrass you, right? She would bring out pictures, look at this, and all the right to life literature, and she would show what an abortion did to people. And, you know, in 1980, 81, 82, nobody talked about those things. You know, it was just kind of like one of those things that was happening. And the abortion rates were astronomical. But she would just put it right out there and say, really, this is what you're for? This is what you're for? And she was so courageous. I remember thinking, wow, I wonder if I would ever be able to do something like that. Because when you're 15, you don't think that you're ever going to be able to stand up to something like that. But something happened along the way. 3 different times in high school and college, girls that I knew became pregnant because they bought into the whole sexual revolution. And all 3 of them wanted to solve that problem. And I was just blown away at the way that people just talked about this like it was nothing, and they would just expect you to take them to this clinic. And I'm like, I can't do that. If you want me to help you and take you to, you know, get care or whatever I'm happy to help you anyway, but I won't do that. And it was really difficult because I lost a lot of friends along the way, and I thought, well, you know what, those aren't friends that were worth having anyway. So I kind of figured that if I had to pick and choose, I was going to pick and choose what I knew was going to be right, even if it left me standing alone, which it did sometimes. The next book that Molly and I talked about was Brave New World. Any of you guys read this when you were back in high school? Read it now. Read it now with the mind of an adult, with everything that you can see today. It is unbelievable. It is unbelievable. You listen to what happened to, at lunch when they were talking about, you know, the sexual promiscuity and the sex ed. Predicted. The destruction of the nuclear family. Predicted. Social engineering of classes of people specifically to keep them in their place so that we had people to do different tasks in society. Predicted. It is unbelievable what Aldous Huxley was able to foresee. And the reason he could see what was coming was because his grandfather was Charles Darwin's lab assistant. And people don't know that. You know, so you look at that and go, oh, it's just a nice piece of literature. So when my daughter, the one that's in Dallas, studying political philosophy, was a senior in high school, she was taking an AP literature class. And she wrote about this book in her class and talked about the prophetic nature of this book with regard to abortion and social engineering and the whole idea of being able to have, you know, designer babies and being able to, you know, pick and choose what you wanted out of society. It's absolutely a eugenics book. Her teacher, who had spent his entire professional career on the AP board, the National AP Board, did not know that this book was about eugenics. Didn't know it. And when she wrote the paper, he's just like, that's a really interesting take. I've never seen anybody say that about that book. I'm going to have to think about that. She's like, just look up who Aldous Huxley is. And he was blown away by that. These are our educators. These are the ones with our top students that, you know, they don't know how to challenge them in these ideas at all because they don't even know the ideas themselves. This book is a personal favorite. It was one of my first books that kind of helped me understand what was going on, and it was Ronald Reagan's favorite book that actually brought him into the conservative movement. He had been an actor. He had been the governor of California. He signed legislation in California that actually allowed for no-fault divorce and abortion rights in California, and then had an absolute crisis of conscience. He's the only sitting president ever to have written a book and published it while he was in office, and it was a book specifically about ending abortion in our time. I don't remember the title, but look it up. It's a short book, but he was the only president in U.S. history to actually have a book published while in office, and it was specifically about ending abortion. But this book, it's called The 5,000-Year Leap, and it talks about why in Western civilization, you know, think about where are the nations that had the best quality of life, the best education, the best healthcare outcomes? It was through Western civilization. Why? That's where Judeo-Christian philosophy thrived, and that's where the dignity of the person was respected. Well, this book does a great job of tracing that whole evolution of thought in society from the medieval times through today. We were talking earlier about Ryan Anderson, who was here a few times over the past few years. This book is called Truth Overruled. It is a great, great book that basically shows how did we get here. This was published right after the Obergefell decision that nationalized gay marriage on equal footing with what we understand traditional marriage to be. And he shows exactly how that happened. This is how I read. I'm an accountant, you know, everything's kind of like in its place. But he does an excellent job of tracing through the legal system, through the education system, exactly what they tried to do. And he traces it through what's called the Frankfurt School of Sociology. And a lot of people don't know that term, but you all know it because you're living it. It was an Italian guy named Gramsci in the 1920s who was watching the outcome of the Bolshevik Revolution, and he was absolutely on board with communism. He was a devout disciple of Marx and Engels, but he was watching what was happening in the Soviet Union saying, they're not really doing it right because people are not purely economic beings. People are relational beings. So if we're really going to achieve the outcome of communism, yeah, the economics matter, but that's the secondary thing. The primary thing is how they live their lives. So we need to do three things. We need to tell them that there's no real morally objective truths. And we need to tell them all these ideas about sexual morality, that's just some patriarchal church shoving down everybody's throats. Just they're buzzkills, you know, they're just trying to take away everybody's fun. So we need to sideline them. And oh, by the way, this whole family thing, you know, people are unhappy in their family, so we just need to figure out a way to free everybody from all of these social strictures. Well, his ideas, of course, made their way to Germany, where most of the bad ideas in the 1800s and 1900s seemed to percolate. And when Hitler came to power as a eugenicist, Brave New World, he was purging the academy of anybody who had ideas that were outside of his strict understanding of, you know, Nazism. So, of course, these good little, you know, sociologists that had drank from the well of Gramsci were in a university in Frankfurt, Germany, and they fled persecution. So where did they go? They went to England and the United States. And where did they go? They went to Oxford. They went to Yale. They went to Harvard. They went to Columbia. They went to Exeter. All of the big schools where they could get into the sociology departments. And what you're seeing now with gay marriage, contraception, abortion, euthanasia is directly out of the Frankfurt School of Sociology that Columbia University specializes in. It's taught every day. It's taught every day. And if you doubt that, turn on the news and look to see what's happening all over your college campuses, and you see you're not even allowed to say that you believe that marriage is between one man and one woman now without having somebody punch you in the face. I mean, it's just unbelievable how quickly they've been able to move their agenda forward because nobody was standing there saying stop. We need to be those people that stop and stand there and say, stop, we're not going to live like this. But that's Ryan Anderson in Truth Overruled. This one is not for the politically correct, so I kind of like it. It's called The Politically Incorrect Guide to Western Civilization. He reclaims the truth of what Western civilization truly was. He goes back all the way, you know, to pre the time of Christ, you know, through ancient Rome, even into ancient Greece, and brings up to today the things that we're dealing with. One of the things that he does really well is talks about Hippocrates, you know, the Greek philosopher that wrote the Hippocratic Oath that all doctors for 2,000 years took. And I didn't know this when I read this book, that the Hippocratic Oath was taken and originally written because he was being asked to perform abortion, infanticide, euthanasia, and other sterilization procedures that he felt were completely immoral. He's just like, that is against the natural law, and there is no way that, you know, even the ancient Greeks who were not, you know, at the time, it was 300 years before Christ, so they certainly didn't have the full redemption of the Christian story at hand, but they understood in natural law that killing a child in a mother's womb had to be bad, right? So he does just a great job of tracing the whole idea of the consequences of ideas all the way through Western civilization. This little book I got from Michael Voris, Vortex. I was blown away by this. It was written in 1917. That year, there are 2 years that stick out in my mind. 1917 and 1968. 1968, Humanae Vitae, the sexual revolution, Woodstock, right? That's when everybody lost their minds, right? Think about American history in 1968. I think one of the big news guys had a book, The Year That Changed It All, 1968, and he shows that at that moment, everything in society, the lid just blew way off. But 1968 and 1917, Our Lady of Fatima, World War II, World War I, the Bolshevik Revolution. In this little book, in England, called Married Loves by a woman who is a OBGYN, Dr. Marie Stopes. And she was so full of compassion. She felt so bad because marriages were unhappy and people were having children that they didn't want. And, you know, women were being forced to be mothers when they really just wanted to work. And, you know, it was really, really unfair. So they needed to be able to have a way to openly talk about using contraception only inside marriage, only when they knew they wanted to have children, but only when they wanted to be able to plan them according to the time that they were financially able to have children. Well, in 1917, everybody in England was like, oh God, don't even talk like that. Think about England in 1917 for anybody who is a history buff, right? They had lived through about 100 years of the Victorian era where, you know. Well, here's these women that were now, you know, well into their age, trying to talk to their daughters who were marriage age. They were not about to talk to their daughters about what it meant to be married, you know, how babies actually came about. You know, so here are all these young men and young women getting married, and nobody talked about that subject. And people were miserable in their relationships. And Brits, I don't think we think of as the most verbal, outgoing people in the first place. So society was miserable. They were very, very unhappy. So in order to be able to open up the dialogue between husbands and wives, they needed to have contraception. I mean, it was just the only way that this was ever possibly going to be a way to be able to save the British marriage. Well, she has this series of letters between herself and a Catholic priest in England. And his response to her is just beautiful, because he's like, I work with these young people, and I understand the pain in marriage, and I understand the lack of conversation, but the solution is not to destroy marriage and their children. The solution is to open up the dialogue so that we can understand the unitive and procreative capacity of the marriage act between a husband and a wife, and that's where it's meant to be. Well, it's a beautiful dialogue. Well, she says, oh, Father, how could you possibly know, because you've never been married, so you can only know by what you hear from people. And she has this whole demeaning tone. Within 12 years, this one woman was able to get the whole Church of England to accept contraception on demand across the United Kingdom. It was amazing. It's called the Lambeth Conference of 1930. And I used to say, okay, Lambeth. Well, okay, that's where the Anglicans get together once a year and they talk about all their things. Okay, whatever. No. Yes, they did get together once a year. But she was able to take this whole misguided idea to the Lambeth Conference, and all of their bishops, they folded like a house of cards. And it only took from 1930 to 1963, I believe, 65, with the Griswold decision in the Supreme Court here that allowed for contraception in the United States, chemical contraception, only within marriage. We would never, ever, ever want that for any other reason. You know, yes, for the, you know, when people have, you know, health issues, you know, whatever, as a medicine. Yeah, we all accept that that's true. But for purposes of family planning, we, of course, only want that to be within marriage, because it would be a disaster for society if we unleashed this. Well, what happened? It only took from the mid-1960s to 1973 to go from no contraception, so okay, contraception only in marriage, to the sexual revolution, to abortion in 1973. It blows your mind how fast, because why? They had been planting these seeds underneath, and they were like termites eating at the fabric of society underneath the underpinnings of what we all, you know, on the outside thought, oh yeah, well, we're Christian. Oh yeah, well, we believe in the family. Oh yeah, well, we go to church. Oh yeah, well, we believe in, you know, objective morality. But no, they had already hollowed out the foundation. So when the strong winds came, they just blew right over, and that's how we got where we are today. Which leads me to Subverted. This book was, I think Molly will attest, the hardest book to review. It's four books in one book, and she has them all intermingled. She was a young Protestant girl that grew up somewhere like in Kansas, you know, just like nice 1950s, married parents, you know, got their first black and white TV, you know, apple pie, mom, baseball, right? The 1950s, America, everybody seemed to get along, seemed to live by the same moral values. The divorce rate was very low. There was no such thing as legalized abortion. You know, people kind of like on the surface just kind of percolated, and it looked like a pretty happy time. Well, she and her husband went through this whole evolution from newly married to, you know, trying to make their way in the horrible economics of the 1970s, and she became a writer for Cosmo. Totally unwittingly being a force for the women's movement and putting forth these horrible, horrible ideas that manifested into Sex and the City, you know, the series and the movie. You got to read this book. It is unbelievable. She talks about her own personal journey, her own experience going through abortion because she and her husband couldn't afford to have that child because they didn't have a job. Married people making the decision to end their own child's life because it wasn't economically feasible at the time. But she fell prey to the whole sexual revolution. All the way through her own personal crisis and, you know, coming fully into the church later in her life before her husband passed away. But she talks about how Roe versus Wade got passed. She knows the people. She names the names. She shows you exactly what happened, how it happened, when it happened, and it is eye-opening. Molly and I were blown away by it. We actually had lunch with her when she was here in the fall, October, and she asked us to help her and Lila Rose in a project they'll be doing over the next year or so, talking about reclaiming feminism the way that it was originally intended to be. I mean, those women that were suffragettes, they did not want the right to vote to be able to kill their own child. That was not what the women's movement was about. She does a good job of talking about that as well, because, you know, if you think about the male-female dynamic, women always worked, right? On a farm, it's hard work for both the husband and the wife and for all their kids. You know, it wasn't until post-World War II when all the men came back and the women who had been working in the factories, they're like, you know, we're going to go home and let all the men have the jobs now because society was reforming and the manufacturing plants were all retooling from a war footing to, a domestic footing. And that's when, all the appliances were coming online. You know, you see the aprons and the nylons and the high heels cooking dinner, cleaning their house. That's how I clean my house. Do you guys clean your house like that? But that was a product of the 50s. So by the 60s and the 70s, women were like, wait a second. We're more than sitting home with a remote control on a TV. You know, we can be mothers. We can be role models. We can do more at the same time as raising our children. Well, that's what it was about. Until, and she does a great job of showing how that happened, the feminist group that came in wanting full reproductive rights on demand just took over the women's movement in like a month. It was unbelievable what they did, and they did it stealth, just underneath the surface. And the women who had been in it early on for purposes of really being able to help their families got absolutely decimated and sidelined. I mean, you even saw that in the Women's March last month after the inauguration, when that disgusting display of women that do not represent me were marching across the Capitol. Well, there were some pro-life women's groups that wanted to also join, and they were told, no, you have no place in the women's movement. So we're not women, ladies. You know, unless you subscribe to everything that they demand that you believe in, you're not a woman. Paul Kengor, I think he was here last year? Last year. This book, absolutely eye-opening. And I love the title. It's called Takedown, and he's got a wedding cake, and he cut it right down the middle. It's called From Communists to Progressives, How the Left Has Sabotaged Family and Marriage. It is just eye-opening. He does similar to what Ryan Anderson does, but this book, I believe, came out before Obergefell, but he was warning what was coming. And he spells out in very clear terms, very easily accessible, very readable, and he shows exactly the footsteps that were taken by the Frankfurt School of Sociology and how you hear people talking about social Marxism. Well, that's the Frankfurt School of Sociology, and that's what they did. They deliberately set out to destroy the nuclear family. Because if you destroy the nuclear family, what do you need? A strong central government. Why? Because if you don't have dad and if you don't have mom united together, you know, as the first educators of the children, as the moral reinforcers, you know, through an organized, influential church within the family, what do you have? You have a strong centralized government. And what can they do? Everything. They decide what you eat. They decide what you learn. They decide what you wear. It's no different than what the Soviet Union did, only they do it stealthily. And we have it here in the welfare system. It is unbelievable what they've done to the urban family. It is disgusting. When I grew up, I grew up in a very integrated community, and every young black kid that I went to school with had a home with a mom and a dad, and they were no different than us. No different than us. And the 10-year difference between when I graduated high school and when my youngest sister graduated high school, when you saw what happened, we grew up in Maple Heights. Unbelievable, the difference in just those 10 years. And they systematically went out to absolutely undermine the family. They absolutely. This is another great book that picks up on the same themes, social justice. It's not what you think it is. Everybody, for a long, long time, when Molly and I first started talking in like 2008, we were both so upset because these social justice organizations were just rolling all over the parish levels of the churches, of the Catholic Church and the Protestant churches. And it only takes a few clicks of the mouse. If you trace social justice on any website, no matter if it's from a church or a school, you end up on a Marxist website within five clicks. And that's not an accident. What happened with... Does anybody remember anybody like 40 and older in the 70s when you heard about all of the revolutions that were happening in South America? Remember how a lot of the priests and stuff with the Nicaraguan Contras and all the South American countries? Well, communism was absolutely digging its roots because after World War II, a lot of people don't know this, when the Allied powers went into Germany and into Italy, all of the rats had to get off the mainland, and a lot of them went to South America. So a lot of the German Nazis, a lot of the Italians that were loyal to Mussolini, where did they go? They went to Argentina, they went to Venezuela, they went to Colombia, they went all across South America. And they went to Cuba. You know, most of the last names in Cuba, if they're not Spanish-sounding, they're German-sounding. And there's a reason for that. All these people with these terrible ideas from Germany and Italy, and I'm German and Italian, they fled. They went to South America. So, you know, flash forward 20, 30 years, now you've got the next generation coming up of all these people who have been drinking from the well of these poisonous ideas. And what happened? These communist revolutions all over society. You see that today in Venezuela after what has happened since Chavez over the past 20 years. I think they have like 1,600% inflation right now. Their money's not worth the paper that it's written on, and they're starving to death. They have no medicine, no access to care at all, and that's the natural consequences of these bad ideas. But he traces the whole bad ideas of social justice and how they've poisoned our churches, our schools, and all of our really well-intended people who have big hearts and they really want to go out there and help people. So they join these social justice groups, and what happens along the way? They lose their faith, and they undermine the nuclear family. How are we on time? Question, Q&A? We've got about 10 minutes. You guys want to do the last part in Q&A?
Well, I've got a question.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Okay. Where can I get a list of your good books, including the ones you've mentioned today?
So have you asked. Turn to page 3 of the handout. All the books that Molly and I have reviewed to date are listed there. Some are easier than others, I'm not going to lie. Some of them require a little bit more thinking. Abolition of Man, if you pick that one up, be patient. Get your mind into like high Brit 1940s style writing. I had to read it a couple times. I gave it to my son, who always reminds me that he's smarter than me because he has more degrees, but he had a hard time reading it. So it's actually very, very enlightening, but you have to get yourself primed for reading British writing. But it's fascinating. If you can do it, it's absolutely fascinating. Probably one to do easily is the Me Before You, the novel that I talked about with euthanasia. If you see the movie, it's chilling because these are the ideas that our kids are being spoon-fed all the time. I haven't seen it, but I heard that just last week or the week before, Disney, on an after-school program, had their first same-sex kiss for the young kids to see, little kids, after-school special. I mean, it's an onslaught.
Next question is, aside from the Bible, what is the most meaningful book that you have read? That's a tough one, huh? For Maria Dean?
No, I'll tell you. It's this one right here. The 10 books that screwed up the world and 5 others that didn't help. It crystallized for me in one place all of the bad ideas that even I had, you know, subscribed to. The whole idea of utilitarianism is so deeply permeating in our thoughts. And even today, if I say something, Anna will go, oh, well, that's utilitarian. I'm like, you know, but it's true. If you read this, and he does it really, really well, because it's 15 distinct chapters covering 15 distinct books. In each of them, he shows what was done, how it was done, why it was done, and what you need to keep in mind when you're, you know, just living your life of how these ideas are impacting our society.
Maria, I asked that silly question. So what would you categorize or classify as the most hopeful book besides the Bible you found?
This one.
It's interchangeable, huh?
Well, no, this one is the 10 books every conservative must read, which is his prescription. He's a professor at Steubenville. He is just a fabulous, fabulous human being. I'll read some of the books in here that he has a book from Aristotle, Politics. G.K. Chesterton, Orthodoxy, which really puts forth what we believe to be objectively true, which was really cool because a lot of people don't know this. When he wrote Orthodoxy, he had been an atheist. In England, in the late 1800s and early 1900s, it was really cool to be a materialist because, you know, Darwin and, you know, all that stuff. So the learned, the wealthy, the influential people, the elite, they were all materialist atheists. And he was kind of like percolating along on this, and he and his wife weren't able to have children, so he kind of jokes that that was God's way of making him read more. So he kind of like stumbled upon becoming a devout Christian because he thought his way through it. He wrote a book called The Everlasting Man, which traces his whole journey through atheism to Orthodox faith. And this was a series of articles that he wrote in the British newspapers refuting the heretics. So he has a book called Heretics and a book called Orthodoxy, where he's having this debate back and forth about what's true and what's not. It's really cool. He has Abolition of Man in here, which Molly and I did, which is just eye-opening. Democracy in America, Alexis de Tocqueville, Burke, Federalist Papers. I mean, this book here is a reclamation of the ideas that will reclaim Western civilization. One thing that he really does well is he talks about Jane Austen. Anybody see movies or read the books of Jane Austen? She's fabulous. 1804, 1805, 1806. Women didn't have the same kind of rights in England that they, you know, would today. So she wrote these stories that were published in a man's name and weren't published in her name until after she died. And her brother said, no. In her memory, we're going to put her name on it. They are fabulous. She understood human nature and the male-female dynamic and the dynamics among family members, among class structures, better than probably just about any author that ever lived. She's just fabulous. Really accessible through movie and through, the books are cheap now because they're over 100 years old, so you can get them for free on Kindle. So I learned that. If it's over 100 years old, it's free on Kindle, except for maybe the, you know, the translation costs. But the one book in here that I highly recommend reading that he calls The Imposter is Atlas Shrugged. Ayn Rand was a secular Jewish girl from the Soviet Union that fled after the fall of communism in the Bolshevik Revolution. Her dad was a very wealthy person, so they fled. But she became an atheist, and she put forth this whole idea of, she called objective morality, but it's not really objective. It's like objectivism. But what she does is she turns morality on its head, and the only thing that's truly good is what's good for you, damned society. But she understood the implications for society of big government and centralized power. So it's this really strange dichotomy where she understood the consequences of all these overreaching bad ideas, yet she put forth a personal morality that led to the same thing she was warning about. So be careful if you read it, because you have to pull those two ideas apart. But her understanding of the economic impact of these bad ideas was profound, truly profound. It's kind of like when you read it, you go, oh, yeah, that's happening now. Oh, yeah, that's happening. Oh, that happened 10 years ago. It's amazing.